First film I ever saw was The Greatest Show on Earth by Cecil B. DeMille. That was the first experience I ever had in the theater. My father said he was taking me to a circus movie, but I didn't register movie, I registered circus, and I stood in line with him in the cold sleet in New Jersey. And I had always imagined a circus taking place in a tent, not a big brick building. It didn't make any sense to me. I expected the curtain opener to see real elephants, and a real lion tamer. And the curtain opener was a big piece of white material, and this flat image came on this white sheet, and it was The Greatest Show on Earth. And my first reaction was that my father had betrayed me. He took me, promised me a circus, and took me to something that I couldn't quite put my finger on, but was not satisfying in any way. I couldn't smell it. I couldn't climb into it, you know. I couldn't be afraid of it. And as I'm watching the movie, suddenly I'm smelling it, I'm afraid of it, and I'm climbing into it. And by the end of the film, I was really jazzed. I remember most about The Greatest Show on Earth, the elephants and the train crash. I remember the spectacle. And perhaps this is a clue to the kinds of movies I've been making.
Give him the whip.
Throw me the idol. No time to argue. Throw me the idol. I throw you the whip.
Give me the whip.
Adios, senor.
Adventure. 40 years ago, the Saturday movie matinee with its serialized cliffhanger was part of a way of life. Adventure movie is with us again. This time, created by a new generation of filmmakers with a love for the great traditions of movie making.
Guys, me, really me. I'm looking. Now, on three, you're on fire. Don't look at me, look where you're firing. One, two, three. Cut.
Working together, George Lucas and Steven Spielberg have recreated the excitement of the classic cliffhanger.
Ryder comes riding up into the camera and he rears back in a dust ball form.
And this is the story of how they did it.
There is an atmosphere to this movie, not unlike a lot of old movies.
Throwback to an older kind of film. It's a high adventure.
You know, filled with inserts and reactions and head turns, and it's a fast-paced, fast-action picture.
Vaguely in the mode of the old Saturday morning serials. I'm really doing it more than anything else so that I can enjoy it. Because I just want to see this movie. You know, you sit back and you say, boy, why can't they make movies like this anymore?
First got a call from George. He said that one of the projects that he had coming up was a project with Steven. That day, Steven came in and we met a writer named Larry Kasdan. And George was introducing people around the room to Larry, and he introduced me as the producer of the movie. And that was it. I mean, it was, you know, an hour later. I mean, that's the way George is. He's just amazing, you know? And we all shook hands, and George said, we're making movie history.
Movie history. George Lucas and Steven Spielberg joining forces for the first time. Their purpose? To pay homage to the Saturday action matinee. But while the old serials were made in a week for $100,000, this production would take 6 months of planning, 3 months of shooting, locations on four continents, and a $20 million plus budget. The saga of Indiana Jones would be a cliffhanger on a grand scale. At Elstree Studios in London, this team is laying the groundwork for the production. Perhaps the most exciting byproduct of any motion picture is the sense of common purpose, an instant commune, part military, part industrial, part social, that is the soul of the movie crew. And these are the people responsible.
And action!
Anything like this, dragging behind a car?
Dragging behind a car. Dragging behind a car.
All right, roll cameras!
No?
Put your head up just a little if you can, that's it.
It's just one more useless experience.
I'm sure it's not dangerous.
See, if it was dangerous, they would have waited till we got more of the movie done.
When Steven Spielberg first heard the story of Indiana Jones, he pictured a new kind of hero and spent 6 months searching for an unknown actor to play the part.
We were stuck. We had 3 weeks to cast the part, and there was nobody close. And then I saw Empire Strikes Back, and I said, Harrison Ford is Indiana Jones. And I called George Lucas and I said, he's right under our nose. And George said, I know who you're going to say. And I said, who? And he said, Harrison Ford. And I said, right.
Indiana Jones is an archaeologist. In his spare time, he, he's a grave robber.
But it's an adventure that has found its own fantastic elements.
About the adventures of a soldier of fortune, Indiana Jones, caught up in a spectacular supernatural treasure hunt.
Indy's girlfriend, Marion, a hard-drinking, two-fisted woman, is played by Karen Allen. This soft-spoken New York stage actress impressed everyone.
You were wonderful.
Thank you.
It was going to be an enormous challenge to me because I've never done this type of film or this stylized type of acting in film. Anytime, you know, you put somebody in with snakes and skeletons and falling down cliffs and all that sort of thing, it's a whole nother ballpark.
Yes, Robert?
Where are you?
In the art department, surprisingly enough.
The sets begin here. Graphic artists and draftsmen working under the direction of production designer Norman Reynolds. The interior sets would be built on the soundstage in London. But the exteriors, such as this archaeological dig site in the Sahara Desert, must be built on location. And the locations could be halfway around the world.
So 3 hours working, about five chops.
I mean, sure. We are spread thin right now because we have construction crews in three countries. And it's hard for the production designer just to get around to see everything.
When we started on this movie, we presented with a script which took place in Peru, in the United States of America, in Nepal, in Shanghai, and in Egypt. So we went to look for locations. We had already decided in principle that we would make the Egyptian part, Tunisia, on the basis that we were not seeing the pyramids, the Sphinx, or the Nile. So it was quite logical we could do it here. We'd worked here before on Star Wars. We knew that the country was suitable, basically.
The art department built scale models for each set. This miniature of the dig site filled an entire room.
Now I'm showing you the panorama photographic montage of the square taken in Tunisia and the model showing the same view, actually. With all due respect, not all directors can visualize everything, you know, from the drawings and plans, because plans are understood by architects and draftsmen and people like that. But when they see a three-dimensional presentation of the thing, it's much easier for them to understand what's going on. And they can also plan much better because they can see the distances. They can see the heights.
Kairouan, a Tunisian village, was chosen because it resembled Cairo in 1936.
Nice. Hey, what's the roof right there? I mean, it is a flat roof.
Yeah.
Can I get up there with the camera?
Yeah.
You built that, didn't you?
Yes, we added that piece.
Well, good.
Right. So,
I'm happy.
In the tight-walled streets and ancient squares, Spielberg and Reynolds discuss logistics. Reynolds will provide a number of small sets to dress up the location.
Yes, we have that, the cart, the fruit stand, big colorful fruit stand over here.
Yeah.
And maybe some other... Now, the thing of it is, he has to have room for that bullwhip. Well, we can't get the crane in here, that's for sure. Unless you can go through the
door. Yeah, you get through there. You probably get through there.
Well, yeah. This should be the location. The little, let's use this instead of the other one.
Instead of that.
Instead of that. Both situations right here. Shoot. It's a hard decision to make because these small areas are very visual.
Yes, they are.
But we don't have enough time to make all these location moves from one to the next.
Spielberg faced a compromise. If he made Cairo smaller, it would be easier to shoot and easier for the audience to follow.
I just wonder if it's as far as the movie's concerned, whether it's just a little bit convenient that everything sort of happens there, you know? That's my only doubt.
But you see, what it does is it gives us a geography. And I think sometimes geography is makes people, an audience, more secure with the story.
Yeah, yeah.
But back in London is where the truly elaborate sets are built. Today, Reynolds pushes to complete the massive Well of Souls set, where Indiana Jones will discover the lost Ark of the Covenant. This is the most difficult set of the entire production.
Simply because of the size involved, the fact that it's 30 feet in the air and the actors have to get from the top to the bottom, and just the physical difficulties involved.
The difficulties in constructing this huge underground tomb were resolved through careful experimentation with models and mock-ups. The set is now completed and ready for shooting.
You know what I should do with you? Go through the whole storyboard.
Spielberg begins the day by reviewing the storyboard, a series of drawings, like a comic strip, that outlines the day's shooting. This will help him show the cast and crew exactly what he plans to photograph. At the beginning of the production, Spielberg made stick figures for every shot. Since then, professionals have redrawn his sketches, and they now become the storyboard, visual script.
Now, here's our first shot today. They all look down into the hole. There's nothing down there. It's all black. Now we're down below looking up.
Indy, why does the floor move?
Give me your torch.
This is the bane of his existence, the snakes. And this will be a special shot where the camera will actually follow you into the hole and down below. Indy takes a firm hold of the rope and it suddenly comes off and falls.
I told you it would be all right!
My big problem in making movies is, especially an action picture, in a very fast-paced sequence, I'm trying to turn the page before I ever finish the shot. I've already shot that thing in my own head. That's done. That's a print. The gag comes off Marion's mouth, and she is unceremoniously shoved into the hole.
Marion! Hang on!
If she falls, she goes into the snakes. But that shouldn't bother her because the fall will kill her. You know. And we hear this huge stone, you know, grinding against stone. The shadow moving over both of them. In the meantime, throws the bullwhip up to the jaw. She's in total black. She screams. He screams in the sheer brute agony of having to push tons of weight with his own body strength. The whole statue topples forward right toward Marion. Indy riding it down the whole way.
I'm going to get some mustard now.
Okay. Suspense is really killing you, huh, Harrison? Okay. This is the best part. You left me at the best part.
Sorry, Indy.
Snakes. Why did it have to be snakes?
We gotta get Robert down here. We don't have enough snakes to make the scene work. Just the set's too big for the amount of snakes that we have. And we hardly have enough small snakes for even an insert. Literally, 2,000 snakes in the set are swallowed up so quickly.
We have to get more snakes.
We have to get more snakes. You know what we really need? We need about 7,000 snakes in addition to the 2,000 we have here to make it work.
7,000 more snakes, please. His assistants nod as though they'd been asked to find paper napkins. But 2 days later, the pet shops of London and Antwerp are bereft of reptiles. In the well of souls, boa constrictors, pythons, and cobras all do their slimy thing.
I mean, there is a serum to protect against cobra bites?
You get bit more, and you've got to get it in 2 minutes.
In 2 minutes?
Cobra bite paralyzes the nerve.
I want one person whose job it is only to keep the pythons away from endangering the actors.
This is a hopeless thing.
Thousands of them. Just get ready to shoot right away.
I'm never going to be able to hit my mark.
Where do you put the figures up?
Let's reconsider this whole thing.
Harrison is in his big boots and his gloves and his pants and his leather clothes and stuff, and I have this little sort of thing and naked arms and nothing on my legs and bare feet. And so I just couldn't stand them on my feet.
Because you come down here and there are 10,000 snakes in this shot, and it's like it's not really happening. It's so stunning. It's. Yes,
right,
exactly.
Okay. What? Traitor, you get your hands off of me!
When I say to you more and more, you give me more, but you give me more in increments of millimeters instead of feet. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It's just that there are some moments where there's a skeleton in the closet. And there's two ways of reacting to the skeleton in the closet. One is to go, aw, shucks, that didn't scare me. And the other is to let your eyeballs pop out. That's what's in the mouth of just. Look at my face. Just. Yes, yes. Right. Okay, good. Here we go. And I began my relationship with Karen by cajoling her and talking very softly to her, and wound up in the middle of the movie just by saying, scream, roll your eyes, look into the camera. Don't look at the camera. Look over there. Action. Cut. Beautiful, Karen. Like, oh, that's terrifying. This is the music right here. That's all you need.
Well, so I'm feeling less and less and less silly.
Yeah, and you're looking better and better. I mean, I love the last take coming down on you today. Every actor needs a different director for each moment. And I think I have to be a different director for each actor moment to moment. But not too big. Almost a hand involuntary.
That's
a lot of the art. Yeah. Can we just do some face jokes? Can I have this man and his wonderful face? And can I have him back there among these women and men right here to be pressed right into the foreground?
Yes.
This guy's face?
Oh, you come with me, son.
Exchange him with the guy with the dirty face. Hat. Yes, exchange them.
Assistant director David Tomlin, Spielberg's physical extension, handles large-scale, heavily populated scenes.
You are here, son. Right.
You're all going to be good actors. So I've explained the story to you.
you picked your champion, so we're going to rehearse it, and you really be rooting for these people because you've got your money on and you have very little money. It's very important that you win, so you must be very serious about it, okay?
Yeah. Also, David, tell them this is a drinking contest. She owns the bar. She's the owner of the bar. Yeah. And this drinking contest happens every Friday night. It's like bingo. Everybody comes to watch her put somebody under the table or be put under the table. So,
right.
So you save your money all week to either lose it or win it on these people.
All right, so don't be inhibited. Really get into it and shout and do anything you want, okay?
Listen very carefully. That was good. Now, wait. Let's talk about this one second. There are two things we're going to change. Now, we can't see your eye if you're looking down here. You have to cheat and look up here. Yes, then we can see. That looks great. Looks like you're totally drunk out of your mind, but you can still see. And at that moment, to stop them, scream that out. Because
they're starting.
Louder.
They're starting.
Right, louder.
They're starting. They're starting.
Great, twice is great. And at that point, everybody freezes and takes the money away. And then, with this glass, it's his turn. What could be nice, I don't want to leave your face for one moment. After the bastori, when you get your senses back, you're still half gone. A little smile like, okay, sucker, it's your turn. Right, great. Okay, sucker, it's your turn.
You
wonderful.
Out.
And then went it out, and then the demonstration of victory, and then down. I don't want to leave your face for one moment.
Let's start it.
There's a demonstration of victory. Hiya. Terrific. You're not done yet, baby. Don't. Karen. You would love it.
That was good? Oh, God. I'm so glad. Come on.
That could be a really nice moment. It doesn't also could be cheated toward camera.
Get down into the layers of all the technical things having to be working all at once. So it wasn't just the acting, it was being aware of what the camera was doing and being in the right light and the right place at the right moment and not getting in each other's way and all of those sort of things. I mean, it was fascinating.
I need one of the pieces your father collected, a bronze piece about this size, the hole in it off center with a crystal in it. You know which one I mean?
Yeah. I know it.
Yeah, see, this is so tight. If you move an inch back, you're out of the shot.
Indiana Jones.
Carol.
Walking back through the... I mean, I'm more nervous under ordinary circumstances. Other kinds of things make me nervous, but doing... being in a movie doesn't really make me nervous anymore. There's probably a tension there that I learned to deal with that I don't acknowledge. But there's nothing operative. There's nothing that I have to deal with before I can do my work.
Okay. You know the second one.
It's frustration. That's different than tension. Sometimes there's a frustration in not being able to make it work. You just have to keep trying. There's a moment before it comes together in which you're both doing separate things,
right.
But when it comes together, you're both doing the same thing, and that's the part that you're going to use.
Energy and fire. We see everything that we want to see in you happen
there.
The moment you look up,
yeah.
Having heard your voice. The whole transition from, oh, my God, to cover up.
Yeah. Indiana Jones. Always knew someday you'd come walking back through my door. I never doubted that. Something made it inevitable. So what are you doing here in Nepal?
I need one of the pieces your father collected.
I learned to hate you in the last 10 years.
That window's on fire. The table's on fire. This is burning. All this whole thing's burning here.
This action scene involves planning and control of a web of elements and details so complex that it takes a crew of experts months to put it together. When these elements do come together, it's pure choreography. A kind of ballet. Every element perfectly timed. Stunts, special effects, overall design, all precisely coordinated. Here, special effects expert Kit West goes over a gunfight scene with Spielberg.
This is a flat squib, which is devised for setting into a wall and gives it a spark, and like ricochets off metal. I basically prefer to do pictures and lots of bangs and explosions.
Bang, 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 bang. We have 20 in each, right?
No, what I've done is I've got 10 and 10 and 5 for your first take.
Great. Okay, so it's 10, 10, and 5.
Yes.
Show it to me again and let me play the machine gun. I'll go pop, pop, pop. This is kid's play. I mean, today I shot my sort of first gunfight.
Pop,
this
pop,
is
pop,
my
pop,
first
pop,
real good guy versus bad guy shoot 'em up. You know, as if you're a perfect marksman. Now watch me.
Yeah.
You aim, yeah. And at the last minute you close your eyes and pull the trigger.
I love it.
Okay?
I love it.
Okay, ready?
We began, which is something I've always wanted to do, we began to choreograph it like a dance, by the number. That's how it's done. That's how it's usually done in movies.
Lovely.
So hit the rubber bag. We're back where we started from.
But also, we use these squibs for the business of blood hits when somebody is shot and the blood comes out. We have a special plate which we set these into.
That's good right there. That's pretty good.
In this scene, the arc is finally opened, and the climax is a tour de force of special effects.
And they bring the arc to the top of this naturally made box canyon. And of course, all they expect to find inside the arc is the Ten Commandments, the Germans. None of us are expecting anything beyond broken stone tablets. But it's said that the tablets were returned to God and that the Ark was destroyed in the Temple of Solomon. But our film, based on what George Lucas's beliefs are vis-a-vis the Ark, is that the Ark was in fact moved and not destroyed in the temple and then discovered by you wonderful people.
It was always that when they opened the Ark, an event took place.
Spielberg knows how the special effects will look and communicates this to his actors. Here, the premise is that like Lot's wife, looking will turn them to stone.
You know, I mean, like you're tired, only your head can move. Like, yeah.
I can't!
Don't look, Marion!
I have to look!
Keep your eyes shut, Marion! Don't open them!
Indy, I have to look!
Though actors must take directions with deadly seriousness, it is not always possible.
The problem with a movie like this, when you don't really know what the effects are going to be until you get into post-production. It's very hard to direct somebody and say, look frightened or look overjoyed or look with awe at something that will not be in for 4 months. Your apparition will come to get you. It'll go around you this way, so you'll turn. I said, John, you'll turn this way. Follow me all the way around. You'll turn. You'll keep going around with your hands up. Try to keep this thing away from you. Just try to keep
bit away from me, like flies, like bees, you know? If you were, exactly, and sort of rotate like that as it sort of spins around you. Let one of the hands, like, kick up, like it's, you know? Good, yeah, great. I know it feels stupid, but it looks great on film, you know? And then suddenly, you look down, like, what the hell is that noise coming from there? And a kind of death mist. Which is a mist that sort of crawls along the steps leading down from the tabernacle and surrounds everybody. And from that mist arises apparitions.
Apparitions from the mind of the director.
Group B, stop! Group A, stop!
Wind machine.
Come back up again. Group B, stop!
The apparitions begin as amorphous clay, then are shaped for animation on film.
I like that same flat look over here, sure. So it's not so rounded. Because he's really good. He's sort of a cross between a kabuki dancer and a girl I once lived with. It's very important that the hands, the separation of the fingers, exactly. And the face, yeah. and the clothing is like this, because yeah. We have to register. The dummy bust of Paul with the real Paul.
Yeah. Paul Freeman is immobilized in plaster. They will create a three-dimensional bust with exactly the same expression as this frame of film. $2. He must hold his grimace of horror, an hour-long ordeal, while the latex and plaster mask is cast. This effect will last only a few fleeting moments on the screen, belying its hours of behind-the-scenes preparation. The result is a likeness that will be duplicated and photographed for the final effect.
We're dealing with a kind of special effect that we haven't used before, and we're trying to come up with a new look.
It's beautiful!
Cast and crew are accustomed to working in the hothouse environment of a studio. But nothing could prepare this crew for the Sahara. Under the Tunisian sun, it was 130 degrees. In the shade, 120. The sun withers Tunisians and foreigners alike. On this remote and barren patch of desert, over 200 kilometers from Tunis and 60 kilometers from the nearest permanent settlement of any size, with 600 extras and a crew of 80, water consumption was prodigious, an average of 5,000 gallons each day. Water is a precious commodity in this part of the world, and water lines are a way of life in the desert. Filming in the desert for nearly a month reduced even the most coherent minds to dusty gibberish.
Norman, do you have any other ideas?
Paul?
Anything. Let's just go off and make another picture.
All right.
Do a picture about, do a picture about a movie crew going crazy in the sun.
He's gone, you know. Flip. The sun. Steve does a great deal of homework when he does a picture. And he's very organized and... I think one of the main reasons that the film is going so well, and we are ahead of schedule at this point, is because Steve also has gained a great deal of technical knowledge on making movies, and he's made these kind of movies before. He knows what to anticipate.
he knows how to make a production move.
Ja, was sollen wir essen? Wir wollen nicht essen. Nein, wirklich. Wir haben gerade gegessen. Danke. Verstehen Sie nicht?
Was, Herr, du warst nicht
essen wollen?
Great. Terrific.
Excellent. Excellent. Really good. Work wonderful. Just beautiful.
Yes. Special effects burn tires to create a hazy background. Too many tires, too much smoke. The scene was too dark.
You mean all this action was too dark right here?
It's very dark through the camera.
What?
It's very dark through the camera. One whole stop on
these things. Well, push it one stop. We'll see the water, we'll see the food fly, we'll see all that. Well, the problem is, if I reshoot this, I'm behind a half a day. Because we have to let them go and rest and everything else. So I would say we have to move on. Let's deliver it. Let's go. That's Hollywood. Next shot. Great, guys. You're good actors.
You know whether the shot doesn't work when you're shooting it, and most people lie to themselves like me. I just sit there lying to myself. I say, well, it'll look better in dailies, it'll work. And I think so many of us walk away lying to ourselves. And of course, the more we lie to ourselves, the more money we save, because it means not having to go back and do 7 or 8 more takes to get it right.
Okay, start the dolly track here.
That's good, because you got a nice
start right
bit of,
here.
Nice bit of something here.
Right, watch right. This. Start right here and go straight across, perfectly paralleling this.
Yeah.
Now, do we have any curved track?
Yes.
Okay, we'll curve off here.
There's a moment in every film, many moments, maybe several hundred moments, where you think you've got the biggest hit of the century. And other moments where you think you're going to walk away embarrassed from this and never be able to live it down. And those feelings sometimes occur within an hour of each other, or within a day, or sometimes they just are pulling you and pushing you during the editing process. You know, a success breeds 1,000 parents, you know, and a failure is an orphan. The important thing about making movies is to stay friends. George and I have been friends a lot longer than we've been working together. George and I have only been working together now essentially for a year. We've been friends for 11. You know, this is a movie that I'm making for George from his idea. It's of his being.
Down there, thank you.
Yeah, like that. We'll be going like this. We'll be moving like this. Yeah, that's great. And cut. Lovely timing.
Okay, thank you.
They had to import every stick of wood, scrap of cloth, or stone. The truck in daily between 5,000 and 10,000 gallons of water. Medication for dysentery. Creams for sunburn. The production involved making traditional Arab costumes for 600 extras.
Okay, great. Here we go.
Making a movie is like fighting a small war. The deaths and accidents are, however, more of the spirit than the flesh. This small war was planned by experts and fought by professionals. Vision and execution come together in a rare and remarkable collaboration.
And we pan a dolly around with Indy as he's heading presumably back to the surveyor truck. And just as he gets about here, Harrison, a convoy comes by, one vehicle with a whole bunch of foot soldiers, and it's like turning away again, and just until the coast is clear, he dips into the tent. Is that logical? Yeah, me too. Okay, well, shoot.
Okay.
Okay.
Shooting in a town presents a different set of obstacles.
It's a case of having to persuade people to close their shops for the day, which is a very difficult thing to do.
Everyone get ready.
The ideal location is the location where you have adequate parking facilities for all your equipment within easy access of every location, which is not the case here. It's very difficult with narrow streets, where you have no problem at all with the local population, where it's completely quiet. This one doesn't have those things, but of course it has the backgrounds that we need.
So our first shot is going to be following our principals up and reviewing the kids with the monkey. So we'll eventually be on Dolly Track, ending in this direction with the whole house and the city in the background.
The problem with the TV antennas is one that you get everywhere in the world now when you're shooting a period film. This movie is in 1936, and the town of Kerouan is covered in aerials. So that was a major logistical problem, to get all those aerials removed. I mean, logistics, they're myriad. There are so many facets to logistics in operating in a foreign country.
Do one more thing for me right now. How did it come before? They came forward okay?
Yeah, pretty good.
Tell them to do it again, but don't point. Laugh, but don't point.
Okay.
Laugh, but don't point.
Shooting in a town like Kerouan, to be honest, you don't know until the day you start what it's going to be like. I was pleasantly surprised because we closed off the main street. I don't know of many cities in the world where we could have done that without creating a riot.
More direct.
Yeah, more direct. More direct.
That's their finished position.
Having got it organized, everyone has a function. All the background then looks logical.
So watch out for their toes, use their brains, and react as they would in a normal situation.
If you have English-speaking people, you can do it very quickly. If you have to go through an interpreter, it takes a bit longer, and then again, you have to live through that and still try and keep a good atmosphere on the floor and stop people from cracking under strain. With this crew, a terrific crew, camera crew, extremely good, best temperament that I've ever come across. Take a lot of aggravation without breaking, which is good.
I hate to admit it, actually, but Chick's been with me for over 30 years. And Robin has been for well over 20 now. It's an incredibly long time, and it's a marvelous relationship. I couldn't live on the floor without them. You know, he rides that camera like a cowboy that does a steer.
Say when, Dougie.
Okay, we can go in this if you like.
It's like a snapshot.
All right, everyone, stand by. We're going to shoot now, please. Get ready. Background, action.
It's you, it's your family, it's your friends. We put it all together, like a string of pearls.
I'm so pleased you're not dead! Indy, we have no time. If you still want the Ark, it has been loaded onto a truck for Cairo.
Truck?
What truck?
Exactly what you had. This is all in
the storyline includes a chase in the grand tradition. Because this sequence promised to be a monumental task in itself, Spielberg created a second unit directed by Mickey Moore.
Then this truck comes around, he's overshot, the car goes through the tent.
Spielberg and Moore used the storyboard to plan the chase. Moore's footage must fit stylistically into the hole.
Anytime we cut to a static shot during the chase, there's nothing worse than having a static shot because we're so used to the movement. We're moving with the trucks, moving with the cars, whether they're mouth shots or car to car. If we have a wind machine or anything blowing some dust in, it'll give some movement to the scene. I'm going to write right here. Glenn says it's going to be spectacular. How do you spell spectacular?
Stunt coordinator Glenn Randall designs, rehearses, and supervises the stunts. He takes responsibility, balancing acceptable risk against effect.
Tell him don't worry about me. You make sure that he's looking to get... Because...
Harrison Ford did some of his own stunts. This was both unusual and risky. For if Ford was injured, the production would be shut down.
Harrison is great to work with. We had to teach him to do things that he had not done before, some things that really hadn't been done in films of recent years. It was quite an experience. I have used a whip before, but this is the first time I've ever had to teach an actor to use it. They can be quite lethal. You could beat yourself half to death with it before you learn how to manage it. And Harrison stuck with it, and he learned quite well. So we incorporated it in several of the fights.
It's all the ingredients put together. It's a good camera mount, it's checking the camera, it's timing the truck right.
The challenge of doing it, it's a unique area that not too many people are involved in. You take all the film stuntmen in the world and all the number of films and television shows that are done, there's a very few number of people that are involved with the actual action sequences. So it places yourself in kind of a unique category, and of course the money is good. So
when you get to the top of the hill, we'll hold your speed and Terry will dress on you. I'll jockey the camera car one way or the other to get the lenses in the position they should be in.
All right, boys, let me know. Gun move.
Stand by.
Right, Mike. Stand by. Shoot him. Clear everything.
Okay, Terry, stand by. All right, let's move the camera car out.
Stand by, you know, you're the apple.
They know the moves, but at 25 miles an hour on a dirt road, they don't always make it.
Whoa. Hold it, Terry.
Nobody has a gun at your head, and nobody's making you do this stuff.
Terry Leonard will try to top one of the classic movie stunts.
It's similar to a stunt that Yakima Canutt did back 42 years ago with a stagecoach, but we're doing it now with a truck. And I did the thing 4 months ago on a movie called The Lone Ranger with the stagecoach and six horses, and it didn't come out as successful as we'd like. The coach ran over both my legs, and I thought I was going to be out of business for quite a while, but luckily I didn't break them, but I just cut a lot of tendons and muscles that they sewed back together, and I healed pretty quick, so I got back in business right away.
He slips and goes underneath of it, and is passed through under the truck, and then catches himself and comes up in the back end. And there wasn't a lot of clearance. So it was kind of a tricky situation.
We're making a sort of a ditch for his body to lay in, which he still only has about 2 inches of clearance when he goes underneath.
You had to be right on the money at the proper speed. If you bounced off of a ditch or something, you've got a man underneath the truck whose life depends on staying on course. You're conscious of somebody being under there, but you can't think about anything other than the fact that you've got to stay right on line.
Plus, if you run over somebody, you know, there's no excuse in the world that's going to take that away from your own mind. Because your life at various times, and I'm not trying to make it sound like every time you go out, you're staring the Grim Reaper in the face. That's wrong. But 10, 12, 15 times through the course of a year, you are hanging it out and letting it happen. And most of the time, you're involved with other people that you trust and respect and have confidence in. And that really is a test of friendship, because they're there when you need them.
No, you can't cheat it too much. It's got to be as much as you can right in there. Wally, line that up, will you?
All right, let's clear here, boys. Let's clear.
So he's not behind the housing?
Okay. Yeah, give me a check, Ted. All right.
Bless you, holler, kid.
All right, stand by. This is picture. Right. Okay, turn it on and go, Romo.
Nobody has a gun at your head. Nobody's making you do this.
Start moving forward. Okay. Stop.
The magic of movies.
The magic of movies. Jesus Christ. Hey, look at this, though. Never know how it was done.
No. The stunt work to me is memories, friends, and 8x10s.
Dangerous stunt is saved for the end of the shoot.
Extra padding in case this throws me into it.
In case of fire, this is the safest way.
Right. Okay, boys, it's all yours. I'm going to get out and let you do your thing.
We take what we call calculated risk. This is a calculated risk.
And we used what we call a cannon to blow the truck over. But I've never blown a 5-ton truck over, and I don't know anybody else has. So we really weren't sure what it was going to do.
And then with an explosion, it blows, boom, it blows them up in the air like that.
Safety harness is fastened to the roll cage. So wherever the roll cage go, Glenn will have to go.
Just before we get ready to shoot, and you're in your costume, you're in your stunning equipment, and you're buckled down, you're ready to go. And you're pumped up, your adrenaline's going, and you're ready. You're ready mentally, you're ready physically, and somebody says, wait a minute, this isn't right, the light's not right, the cloud just came over. That kind of waiting is the most aggravating. That's a classic situation of pressure. That was our last day of shooting. Everybody's ready to go home. It was the last shot of the day. That's why you get paid the big money, because of that kind of pressure.
Okay, all he's got to do now is to get up into there and just join them onto the cannon.
Is he ready?
He's ready. How ready?
Roll the cannon.
Right, turn over!
Just lovely! It would work because it was a whole concept master. I mean, it was just the explosion, but he comes right into a close-up like this and reacts to it.
He's back.
There may be
more
stuff in there.
It's a good symbolic get me out of Tunisia shot. That's wonderful.
Super.
That's it.
Boom!
Woo! No, it's a wrap!
As we come to the end of it, I mean, I feel both relief that we've got through and also sadness that it's over, because every movie you work on is an experience, it's a bubble in your life, it's a time capsule, and it's never ever going to come together the same way ever again. So it's an experience which is coming to an end, and I think There are few of us that don't feel a form of sadness at the end, as well as the relief that it is over. You never stop learning. Each one is a new experience, a new country, different set of rules, different personalities, and different technical problems. And I think part of the fascination for me about making pictures is that it can never become dull because you never know it all. Your apprenticeship is for life.
I wanted to work so hard and come in so far under schedule. But in the long run, I think it'll be better for the film because there will be much less self-indulgence. There was no time for it, just to tell the story. So I'm very happy with the movie. We'll see how I feel 10 years from now when I look at it for the first time.
Oh, Jesus. I feel just like we won either the World Series or the Super Bowl.
Steve, congratulations.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. You guys are great too, by the way. Thank you very much. See you in the cutting room.
Well.
I feel fine. I feel great. I'm very happy with what we did. And I'm glad it's over. It's the toughest job I ever had.